there are few foods that have PR as good as Greek yogurt. This international ingredient is rich in probiotics and protein and touted by fitness fanatics across the world as the perfect companion for granola and fresh berries. But this superfood does have a dark side. If you've seen my last video on yogurt, you already know how it's made. But here's a quick history recap. At some point, thousands of years ago, humans discovered that if you add specific strains of bacteria to milk, it'll ferment the milk and the bacteria will convert the milk's lactose into lactic acid. The result is a thick, creamy condiment that we call yogurt. It's sour, delicious, nutritious, and a versatile cooking ingredient. But regular yogurt is still quite runny and thin. Many of us prefer our yogurts more viscous, like Greek yogurt, Skyr, or Lebneh. These strained yogurts are all made in the same fundamental way. You take a regular yogurt and you strain it to separate out the liquid component, which we call acid whey. The longer you strain the yogurt, the more concentrated and viscous it becomes. Yogurts that have been strained in this way are thicker, more creamy and velvety, and higher in protein than regular yogurt. But the acid whey that's left behind is more or less useless, and it's an environmental nightmare. Hi, I'm Adam. I'm a home cook on a journey to learn more about food and cooking, from history and the environment to new recipes and ways to cook. And today we're talking about acid whey, a byproduct of yogurt and cheese production, why it's harmful to the environment, and what you can do about it. In 2013, twice a day, a lorry loaded with 8,000 gallons of acid whey arrived at Neil Regman's New York dairy farm. Although unbranded, the truck belonged to Chobani, one of the leading yogurt producers in the United States. The acid whey was a byproduct of their Greek yogurt production. Unable to dispose of the whey through any other means, they resorted to literally paying Regman to take it off their hands. And there was a lot of acid whey to take. In general, for every kilogram of Greek yogurt that's produced, 2 to 3 kilograms of acid whey is also produced as a byproduct. You'd expect that this translucent liquid would be pretty easy to dispose of. I mean, it's basically just water, isn't it? But no, disposing of whey is actually quite a challenging undertaking. You can't just chuck it down the drain. First, that would be illegal. Second, when acid whey is mixed with water, its acidity starves the water of oxygen. Thus, if the quantities of acid whey that Chobani were producing were dumped into, say, rivers or seas, hundreds and thousands of fish and other sea creatures would die. And this has happened before. In 2007, a dairy company again in the United States spilled 30,000 gallons of whey into a river. According to a government wastewater engineer, it killed everything. So no, that's not ideal. Well, what other options are there? You can't mix it into soil in meaningful quantities either, otherwise it'll make the soil too acidic to grow anything. One approach you may be thinking about is commercialization. Why not just use the whey for protein powder or something? Well, acid whey, which is a byproduct of Greek yogurt, is different to the whey that's used in protein powder. That whey is a different kind of whey called sweet whey. While sweet whey is also a milk byproduct, it's actually a byproduct of hard cheese production, like cheddar cheese or Swiss cheese. It's considered a lot more valuable because it's got a much higher protein content than acid whey, hence its use in protein powder. So what can you do with acid whey? Well, if you're Chobani, you're making so much money from Greek yogurt that it's just cost effective to sell it off. Why not make it someone else's problem, right? And someone else's problem it became. But acid whey is just as problematic for the farmers as it is for Chobani and the other dairy producers. Neil Regman tried everything from adding the whey to cow feed and plant fertilizer to mixing it with animal manure, which was burnt underground to generate energy. These solutions are useful to get rid of small quantities of acid whey, but they're hardly sustainable. When too much acid whey is added to cow feed, it upsets the cow's stomachs. Too much acid whey in the fertilizer, and as we discussed, it'll acidify the soil. The last approach, converting manure to energy, works pretty well, but it's not cheap. The approach requires an underground tank known as an anaerobic digester. Regman's digester cost $4.5 million. Most farms can't afford that sort of investment. The crazy part is that Chobani's acid whey story only scratches the surface. In 2015, an estimated 771,000 tons of Greek yogurt was produced in the United States. That means between 1.542 million to 2.313 million tons of acid whey was produced from Greek yogurt production in the United States alone. 1.5 to 2.3 million tons of acid whey from just Greek yogurt, just within the United States. But Greek yogurt isn't the only popular dairy product that has an acid whey byproduct. For starters, no pun intended, many other yoghurts like Skyr and Lebneh are produced in the same way. The only difference is that these yoghurts are strained even longer and thus produce even more acid whey. Then there's a category of cheese known as acid coagulated cheese. Acid coagulated cheese is made by boiling milk and then, once the milk's at a boil, adding a small amount of acid to it, for example citric acid or vinegar, so that the milk solid, the curds, separate from the milk liquids, the acid whey. The milk solids that are left behind are the cheese, whereas the milk liquids are that byproduct, acid whey. Paneer, ricotta, cottage cheese and cream cheese are all examples of acid coagulated cheese. And the figures are astonishing. For every kilogram of this kind of cheese that's produced, 10 litres of acid whey is left behind. 10 litres. One report estimates that the acid whey produced in the European Union alone was 40 million tonnes per year. I don't have complete figures, but a report by the EU estimates that globally, we produce 180 to 190 tonnes of whey annually. The only thing is, though, the report doesn't specify how much of that is acid whey and how much is sweet whey. Either way, the numbers are conclusive. We're producing a shitload of acid whey. Worse still, as we as a society get healthier, we're going to be eating more and more healthy, high-protein products like low-fat cheeses and strained yogurts. And that means even more acid whey to deal with in the future. Looking at the numbers, it's clear that this trend is already beginning. Yogurt sales in the United States amounted to $7.24 billion US dollars in 2021, up from $5.6 billion US dollars in 2011. It all might sound a little bit daunting, but there is hope. We are aware of the problem, and solutions are being worked on. In 2017, there were already 3,500 acid whey related patents filed in the US. The proposed solutions are pretty eclectic. We've already discussed the uses for acid whey on the farm, you know, adding it to fertilizer or feed or mixing it with manure to produce energy, but there is a bunch of other ways that people are trying to make use of it. Most of the ideas are in the food sector. Acid whey may not be as high in protein as its sweet counterpart, but it still has some protein, as well as being high in lactose, probiotics, and other minerals and nutrients. Some people are trying to isolate these different nutrients and minerals for various applications. For instance, if the lactose in acid whey can be isolated, it can be used as a sweetener. Another potential use is as a fortifier. If the minerals, probiotics, or protein from the whey can be isolated, it can be injected into various foodstuffs to make them more nutritious. One of the many ambitious approaches comes from a startup called The White Mustache, which is an excellent name, who are trying to market the whey as a flavoured health tonic. Arla Foods, a Danish dairy company who market their products worldwide, invented a product called Neutralac a few years ago. It's essentially a protein powder that can be mixed with acid whey to produce various dairy products like cream cheese. Beyond this handful of interesting ideas, there's a whole bunch of other products and solutions being worked on, but as of yet, nobody's achieved that winning formula. Part of the reason for this is that not all acid whey is born equal. The nutritional composition of acid whey is different depending on how it was produced, so whether it was from yogurt or cheese and which kind of yogurt and cheese it was. For instance, acid whey from Greek yogurt is higher in protein than acid whey produced from cottage cheese. That means that a one-size-fits-all application for acid whey is unlikely to exist. There's still lots of work to do. We need to learn more about the nutritional components that make up acid whey, figure out better processes to isolate those components, and also learn more about the nutritional impact on us, humans. But we need to act fast. The industry is growing so quickly, and we're producing gallons, literally gallons of acid whey every single day. So now that we know there's a problem, what can you do about it, if anything? Your gut reaction may be to eat less Greek yogurt or strained yogurts or acid coagulated cheeses, right? But let's be honest, that's not going to make any meaningful difference. I mean, from an environmental point of view, there's a separate argument that says that we shouldn't be eating any dairy or animal-based products anyways, but that's a separate thing. Let's assume that we are eating animal products. Giving up these specific dairy products is not going to make a difference. Consumer choice is important, definitely. We need to set an example for others to follow, but I don't think it's the solution for this problem. I mean, acid whey isn't inherently bad for the environment. It's how we use it that's bad. So if we can find a way to valorize and actually make use of this byproduct, then the environmental problem isn't a problem anymore, is it? So if we can use acid whey meaningfully, then we shouldn't have a problem eating the products that produce it, essentially. again, putting the argument of whether or not we should eat dairy at all aside. So then maybe one option is to actually make these products yourself. I mean, it's not too difficult to make Greek yogurt or Skyr or Lebneh or any of these acid coagulated cheeses. I mean, I've already done a video on making paneer, and the process for making other acid coagulated cheeses aren't that different, really. Greek yogurt and the other kind of strained yogurts are also pretty easy to make as well, and I've already explored that a little bit in the previous video I did on yogurt. So let's say you've went ahead and made some yogurt or cheese yourself. What do you do with the whey now? It's got a bit of a sour yogurty taste, but you can use it basically anywhere that you would use water. So for stocks and stews, or to boil grains. You can use it in smoothies. I'll probably do a different video later exploring all the different ways that we can use it. But for now, just know that you can use it wherever you use water. While making these products at home is a step in the right direction, I'm not sure this is a solution either, really. I feel like with most environmental issues, we need solutions that are wide-reaching across the industry. We can't just rely on individual action. So if you want to help, why not get involved and figure out some creative ways to make use of this acid whey? I mean, there's clearly a gap in the market here. Someone just needs to take advantage of it. That person's definitely not me, but it could very well be you. If acid whey can be valorized and commercialized like its sweet counterpart, then this could be worth a fortune, and you'd be doing the environment a huge, huge favor. Thank you so much for watching. I'm constantly cooking, experimenting, and researching to learn more about food and cookery, and I share what I've learned every week. If you want to learn more about the food that you cook and better ways to cook it, please consider subscribing to the channel. I'll see you in the next video.